Hi, I'm Jimmy. In this video, we're going to look at how we can value a company that isn't profitable. We're going to use Tesla as our case study. Even though Tesla's been profitable for the past couple quarters, either way, the concept still works. So we're going to be using a method called enterprise value to EBITDA. Now, this is not intended to be an analysis of Tesla as a company or as a business. It's really about how we can use enterprise value to EBITDA as a way to value a company like Tesla or even a company like Beyond Meat, which also hasn't been profitable, although it looks like they might be making a turn soon. Okay, so let's dive into what enterprise value to EBITDA is and how it could be used. First is enterprise value. Often we can shorten that to EV. So you might hear this called EV to EBITDA. Then EBITDA is short for earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. Now, let's look at how we can calculate this and how we can use it to properly buy a company like Tesla at a decent price. And then we'll see if we can apply it to Tesla's stock and hopefully see if we can come up with where it could be a good value. Okay, so what is enterprise value? Well, enterprise value is essentially the current value of the operations of the business. And if we think about it, this is both logical and very important for us to realize. We're trying to value the operations. So over the past 12 months, Tesla isn't profitable, so something like a price-to-earnings multiple doesn't work since the earnings number would be negative. But certainly that doesn't mean that Tesla isn't worth anything. So what if we could find something to value the operations of Tesla? Well, that's essentially what enterprise value does. And to calculate enterprise value, here's what we do. First, we add the market value of the common stock. Then we would also add any preferred shares, although preferred shares aren't nearly as popular as common shares. Well, once we have the market value of the common shares, we add the market value of the debt. Next, we add what's known as minority interest. And then finally, we subtract cash and any short-term investments. Now, at first glance, this might seem a bit counterintuitive. Why are we subtracting cash and why are we adding debt? But hopefully this will all make sense as we walk through this. So first, let's start with our first piece. We want to add the market value of common and preferred shares. So as far as common stock is concerned, what is the market value? Well, this is fairly easy to get. It's simply the market cap of the company. What is the market capitalization? How much is the entire company worth? So the first number is essentially, we take the market cap of the stock out there. Okay, so that's simple enough. Now, the next one probably trips up some people. I know it tripped me up when I first started learning about EV to EBITDA. So next, we are adding the market value of the debt. Now, this might seem at least a bit, it might not seem obvious as to why we're doing it. Why are we adding debt? Isn't debt a bad thing? And how does this add to the operational value of the business? Well, here's how I visualize it. And hopefully this helps other people sort of see the concept. Option two is we could always just memorize the formula if we want. Either way would work. But for me, I find it much easier to accept if I understand why we're doing something. Okay, so let's pretend that you and I were to go out and start a business. And when we go out to start a business, we go out and we raise some money. Now we decide to sell $5 million worth of stock in our company to the public or to whomever it is. And then we decide to borrow $5 million more by issuing some bonds. Well, assuming that we take that cash and immediately start building out our operations, well, what's the hypothetical value of our operations at that point? Well, we can't say it's just the equity contributing to the overall value of the operations. Heck, that's only accounts for half of the money we have right now, or half of the operations that we've set up. So in theory, this business, the operations of this business would be worth $10 million since $10 million would have been invested in those operations. So that's why we add debt, because debt adds in theory to the operational value of the business. But to make things even more confusing, now we go ahead and we subtract cash. Why? Isn't cash a good thing? Well, it is, sort of, but is it really? So with our same example, 50% stock and 50% debt. But let's roll this back for a second and pretend that when you and I started the business, we went out, we sold the same $5 million worth of stock, same $5 million worth of debt. But this time we hold on to the cash that we raised and we don't go ahead and set up the operations just yet. So right now we're sitting on $10 million in cash. So let's ask a question. What is the business worth? Well, our first answer might be, well, it's worth $10 million. You got $10 million sitting in cash. That's true. But what if we were trying to value the operations of the business? Well, we didn't set up the operations yet. Okay, so the operations, or better known as the enterprise value of the business, is zero. We have $5 million in stock plus $5 million in debt minus the cash we have, and boom, we're down to an operational value of zero. Now, of course, I'm oversimplifying this in the example, but I just want us to logic out why each piece of the formula exists. Okay, now the final piece is minority interest. So minority interest is the percentage of a subsidiary that the company doesn't own. So Tesla calls this non-controlling interest. You might hear it called minority interest, might hear it called non-controlling interest. Either way, it's the same thing. But basically, here's how this works. Imagine Tesla goes out and buys a company, but they don't buy the whole thing. They buy 80% of another company. Well, by rule, because they have controlling interest in that company, well, Tesla is required to account for the entire company in their financial statements. So this is Tesla's income statement for 2019, or a rough version of it. And basically, well, let's say they had $24.5 billion in revenue. Well, what if Tesla generated $23.5 billion in revenue and the subsidiary that they owned generated the other billion? Well, on this financial statement, Tesla lists the entire $1 billion that gives them their consolidated revenue, even though they only own 80% of that other company. Gross profit, same thing. How much did Tesla generate in gross profit? Well, add that to their subsidiary, 100% of it gets pushed together. And it keeps going right on down the line until we get to net income for 2019, which was about a $775 million loss. But now Tesla goes ahead and say, wait a second, we don't own 100% of that company. Well, now they account for the fact that they only own 80%. The other 20%, in this case, accounted for about $87 million in profits. So Tesla takes that, subtracts the $87 million that wasn't theirs, and that's how you end up with the actual GAAP profit of an $862 million loss. Okay, now this brings us to the valuation part of Tesla. And if the minority interest thing is still a bit confusing, hopefully we'll clear that up in a moment. Okay, so we know we're trying to use enterprise value to EBITDA to value Tesla's stock. Okay, so we know the formula for enterprise value. We just ran through that. And I did the math. Their enterprise value right now is about $148 billion. Now we need EBITDA. Luckily, this formula is a bit easier since EBITDA is short for earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. So I did the math for that as well. And I actually made an adjustment because Tesla had a one-time charge or a one-time restructuring charge. So I added that to EBIT. EBIT is right here on the income statement. So going back to the minority interest, we know that for EBIT, on the financial statement, that is accounting for 100% of that minority interest, 100% of the subsidiary that is owned. Minority interest isn't taken out until you get down here. So since we're using EBIT and then we're going to add depreciation and amortization, you have to add back the minority interest since that's 100%. Enterprise value assumes 100%. So that's why you're adding it back. So when we do the math, we got an EBITDA value for Tesla of about $2.2 billion. Now, this works just like a PE multiple would. We take the enterprise value, we divide that by EBITDA, and we get an EV to EBITDA multiple for Tesla stock of about 66x. And that's based off of the current market cap. Now the question is, what should it be? Well, this is a long-standing debate for nearly every company. We can look at their own history. We can look at other companies, other competitors. We can look at the market overall and try to gauge where it might be. So at the end of 2019, they had an EV to EBITDA multiple of about 38x. That's using the market cap from the end of 2019 and the previous 12 months. At the end of 2018, they had a multiple of 37x. Now, if we compare Tesla's stock to other car companies, well, Tesla may seem way overpriced since Ford has an EV to EBITDA multiple of about 2x. If we go with a slightly more expensive car, a BMW has an EV to EBITDA multiple of 7x. Now, I saw a bunch of comments saying, well, Tesla is a technology company. It's not really a car company. So Ford and BMW are bad comparisons. And maybe that's true. I also heard them say, I also saw different comments saying it'd be closer to a company like Apple or Google or Facebook because these companies are more software driven, more technology driven. Okay, so if that's what we want to compare it to, well, Apple is trading at about 17x, Google's sitting at 20x, and Facebook is sitting at about 18x. So even if we took the high end of those comparison points, that's 20x, which implies that Tesla is more than triple overvalued from where it should be if we think it's a comparable company to Google. So the question is, where do investors, should we buy it at this level? Clearly, my opinion is, no, I don't think we should. I think it makes sense to wait for the stock to pull back or for profits to catch up, because a multiple this high seems very unsustainable. So this might raise the question, when do we buy a stock like this? And or when do we buy any stock for that matter? Well, I actually did a video on when to buy a stock that could be a good next video for you to watch. I focus more on identifying the fair value of the company and then looking and then assigning an appropriate margin of safety to our valuation. Try to buy it at that point or below. So if you're curious, that could be a good next video to watch. There's a link here and there's a link in the description below. And I really want to thank you for sticking with me all the way into the video. I really appreciate it. Thanks. I'll see you in the next video.